Kyle, Arthur Whitecrummy here, the political reporter with the Regina Leader Post. I'm here with our political columnist, Murray Mandrick, to talk about the co-op refinery dispute. Why do you think that they're losing? I mean, we don't have polls. We don't know what's happening at the bargain table. What do you see in either their tactics or in the current situation with the police right now that leads you to believe that
they're losing? Well, it's easy to believe that they're losing because they're still on the picket line and that's not coming forward. And this, when we're trying to read the tea leaves right now as to whether this is a step forward, that very notion suggests that they're not exactly making great progress, right? Now, tactically, I think that they've made a few mistakes. I don't think they anticipated co-op wanting to have them out that long. I think they really thought the pressure that they could impose on co-op through either its membership, because it is a co-op, or through its customer base, people who would stop shopping at co-ops or stop using service stations or just stop the flow of fuel, that they would be able to win that. So far, they seem to not have done that. And as you saw on the weekend, they've upped their game in that regard with their position in Alberta to basically try and slow down the flow of fuel in places like that as well. So at this particular point, tactically, I don't think they win. From a public standpoint, anytime you break the law, you are basically seen as losing if you're a union. That we have this incredibly weird situation where we have the police of chief of police in Regina charging someone with a criminal offense, and it is a criminal offense in terms of
public mischief,
and then basically sitting down and acting almost in the role of a negotiator, mediator in this labor dispute is just, to me, frankly, bizarre. You know, that's not the role of Chief Bray. I very much respect the way Chief Bray has handled the situation, but this is simply not his role. So until there is another avenue for the union where they're not, where they're negotiating with somebody other than Chief Bray, who, according to the rest, doesn't necessarily seem to be on the union side or anybody's side, I don't think they're really going to be moving forward.
If this does return to the bargaining table, who has the leverage right now? Who is in a better situation to force the concessions that they want the other side to take? I mean, we have a refinery that remains under blockade. We have a union that's facing an injunction that makes that very blockade illegal. Who's in a better situation if they return to the table?
Well, right now, I think the company is in a better situation up to the time when there is a significant problem at the refinery. And we're dealing with a refinery there, and we have to take seriously not just occupational health and safety concerns because of the nature of what's happening, but what could happen at a refinery if it's not run properly. And I think co-op and the government are taking a bit of a risk here, because should somebody go, something not happen and somebody be responsible, it will be the company that will be ultimately responsible for anything in that regard.
So the two sides, as of just a few weeks ago, remained extremely far apart. We had Unifor demanding that their defined benefit pensions remain untouched, the company still asking the workers to pay 11% into that pension plan. Recently, we've seen the union retract some of those, what they were calling preconditions. Does that signal to you that the union is starting to bend?
Well, or get smart about when where they need to go to actually get a deal done. Tactically, maybe this is what they had intended all along, and knowing full well that at some point or the other that there's going to have to be some acceptance of some level of change. They are going to make the argument that the company needs to make these employees whole. The company argues, well, we kind of have already, and no one's really going to be affected if you were in this pension before a certain date, et cetera, et cetera. Maybe the company has to move a little bit more. I think probably would help if Diaz wasn't around for most of the negotiations, because I think he's a bit toxic in terms of both co-op and the government, or the government kind of likes to have him around because they see him associated to Trudeau, etc., etc. But I think maybe it's going to be solved more locally through negotiations than it would be with the tactics that we've seen from Diaz and the others that have come in. But who's to say? Maybe we'll look back at this historically and say, yeah, that's what really moved the whole events forward in terms of coming to a resolution to this impasse.
When this is all over, who do you think will have had to give up more from their original position?
Oh God, I don't know. I'd be making more money if I could make predictions like that. I think generally speaking, the union is going to have to give up at least a little bit more than they thought they would, or some of them thought they would. But I don't know if necessarily management is going to get out scot-free either and do exactly what they want to do. I think it'll depend on a whole other bunch of factors. But I think they're both going to have to give a little. If I had to guess, probably the union a bit more because of the nature of this. But I don't necessarily think that that will make them huge losers in this. I think there's ways for the company to make them a bit more whole than they are right now. And this is still a very, very profitable place to work. And there's every reason for the co-op workers to sit and say, well, you guys can afford this. And that's a pretty compelling argument to put forward to anybody. I guess that's why they wanted to go to arbitration.
Well, that's it from us for today. So thanks for sticking with us to listen to Murray's take on the co-op refinery dispute.